In Allah's name, the most compassionate, most merciful. Praise is due to Allah. We thank Him, we seek His help, His guidance and forgiveness. This continuation of reading in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari, rahmatullah alayh, this chapter number 35, concerning the reward of whoever is held back from jihad by illegal cause. Narrated Anas, we returned from the Ghazwa of Tabuk along with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Narrated Anas, while the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Ghazwa, he said, some people have remained behind us in Al-Madinah, and we never crossed a mountain, pass or valley, but they were with us, i.e. shared the reward with us. As they have been held back by illegal excuses. This is a new chapter in the collection of Imam al-Bukhari, rahmatullah alayh, which comes after the previous chapter concerning the ditch that been utilized for the battlefield. And we had mentioned something briefly last class concerning the chapter of digging the ditch or the trench around the Medina, and had mentioned that Salman al-Farisi, one of the companions, may Allah be pleased with him and them all, is the one who had suggested this idea to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had adopted this idea from his people before Islam was in the Persian people. And this brings us to a question about the permissibility of utilizing things that utilized by the non-Muslims or imitating them or being similar to them in certain things. And this brings us to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whosoever imitates a people, he be one of them. But the term at-tashabbu, it comes from the root word at-tafa'ul. And the fa'ul is different from fi'l, which is doing something. So at-tashabbu, which is on the term of at-tafa'ul, that means a person doing something with intention, meaning to do it with no benefit, will return to him or anybody else. He doing it for the fun of it. He doing it to be similar to the non-Muslims, out of love, out of loyalty. If a person do something similar to the non-Muslims, but there is benefit will return to him, it may be similarity, but this is not what been meant in the hadith. And there is no harm in it. As long as there is a benefit will return back to him or to the others. We can see this in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Most of the wording, like the sword that he used to use, was not known to the Arab, this kind of styles. Also we see this idea which has been adopted and been suggested by Salman, this is not something known to the Arab. And also other things like Kol al-Manjaniq, which is something similar to a cannon. So these things, which is originated by the non-Muslims, is no harm for a Muslim to do it as long as there is a benefit in it. But a person to do something only to look like them, out of the love of them, and there is no implicit coming back to him, this what is forbidden, and this what we call it the imitation of the kuffar. And this is not only limited to the weapon and the styles of war and how to fight, but this will be a general ruling to anything that it have a benefit for the Muslims or to the Muslims in general. As example, maybe the traffic lights or organize the traffic or the buildings or any other system that they may have, which a benefit will come out of it for the Muslim. There is no harm to adopt this and to do it, and this is not going to be what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had forbidden. of this that Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi, to continue with the new chapter concerning a person that then hold back from the jihad due to legal execute, which this chapter is similar to a chapter that I mentioned before when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about those who are not equal who fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those who remain back at home. But the chapter before was relating to those people who are being held back from fighting due to illness, sickness, old age, handicap. But a person can be maybe healthy, but other reasons may come in his way which make him not be able to participate in the jihad. And the Shaykh Hafizahullah had given example with those who called him al-Batta'un, or those who came crying, those people who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were willing to go for jihad and fighting in the cause of Allah. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have enough rides, camels, horses, etc. to take them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam apologizes him by letting them know that he don't have enough rides to carry them. They are in the bed to their houses with tears, crying, fearing sorry that there is no rights for them. So maybe the person is sincere in his intention and he really wants to participate in jihad, but the road or the exits or the means to take him there or whatever it is not available, accessible to him. That means he has no defect in his body, but there is other excuse had held him back from this. This person who has this right intention and then prevented from jihad for illegal excuse, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had informed us in this hadith which reported by Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, they will have the same reward equal to those who had went out to jihad like those who actually there. And it came the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam which he mentioned. Mentioned that this was in Ghazwa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, some people have remained behind us in Al-Madinah and we never crossed a mountain, pass or a valley, but they were with us. I.e. that we've been with them, sharing the reward, having the same kind of blessings. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained to them, whenever they climb a mountain, or whenever they cross a valley, whenever they move or sit, at any time, whatever blessing that they're getting, those people is getting the same, although they are still in the middle, back in their houses. But they did not remain in their houses because they are lazy or they are not ready for this expedition, but with a legal cause that prevents them to participate in the jihad. And this is teach us that we would have to have the right intention that after this, if something prevents us, that inshallah we be rewarded for our intention. And after this, Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi, he had mentioned something concerning the chain of narration, and he mentioned that first narration is more authentic, which has no person in between Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, and Hamad. But Ajar, which he explained the book of Shaykh Imam al-Bukhari, he was the notion that both hadith or both chain of narration are acceptable and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Wallahu a'lam. Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi ala brought a chapter concerning the superiority of observing fasting during the battlefield in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mentioned hadith narrated by Abu Sa'id, may Allah be pleased with him, I heard the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, whosoever observes siyam, fast, for one day in Allah's court to seek his good pleasure, Allah will keep his face away from the hellfire, a distance covered by a journey of 70 years. Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi wrote this chapter which concerning fasting, the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that because Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi understood this related to al-jihad because the statement of seeing fi sabilillah in the cause of Allah. While the people of knowledge is saying that fi sabilillah, that means for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the reward of Allah. So whatever good deed that you're doing, from fasting or whatever it is that you're doing for Allah's cause, is in sabilillah, does not have to be that you are in the battlefield. Nevertheless, if a person by fasting, this will weaken him and make him unable to fight in the cause of Allah, will be better for him to break his fast. As for the person who have the ability, have the strength to fast and to do jihad in the same time, he should do so, because the great reward which been mentioned in the hadith. And also the term of 50 years, this meant to be that how great and how much reward the person will receive does not have to be exactly 70. And we understood all this because there is another narration which he came, and the Prophet ﷺ said in it 100 years. So as a result of this, we understood that what the Prophet ﷺ meant by this, that a great number but does not have to be exactly 70, and Allah knows best. This is a chapter concerning the severity of expending it in Allah's cause, i.e. in jihad. Narrated Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever spends two things in Allah's cause will be called by all the keepers of paradise, who will be saying, oh so and so, come here. Abu Bakr said, oh Allah's messenger, such a person will be never destroyed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I hope you will be one of them. Narrated Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, may Allah be pleased with him, that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ascended the pulpit and said, nothing worries me as to what happened to you after me, except the temptation of the worldly blessings which will be comfort in you. Then he mentioned the worldly pleasure. He started with the one, i.e. blessings, and took up other, i.e. pleasure. A man that obtained, O Messenger of Allah, can the good bring about evil? The Prophet ﷺ remained silent, and we saw that he was being inspired of divinely. So all the people kept silent without. Then the Prophet ﷺ wiped the sweat of his face and asked, where is the person who asked the question? Do you think wealth is good? He repeated thrice, adding, no doubt, God seeing nothing but good. Indeed, it is like what grows on the banks of the stream, which either kills or nearly kills the grazing animals because of glutting, except the vegetation eating animal, which eats till both its flanks are full, i.e. till gets satisfied. And then stands in the sun and defecates and urinates and again starts grazing. This worldly property is a sweet vegetation. How excellent the words of the Muslim is if it is collected through legal means and spent in Allah's cause and on the orphan, poor people, the traveler. But he who doesn't take it legally is like an eater who is never satisfied, and his wealth will be witness against him on the day of resurrection. This chapter which Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi recorded in his concerning spending in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one of the types of jihad. There is a different type of jihad, and jihad also can be through spending the cause of Allah and giving your money for Allah's sake. And in some verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started with money before the soul and the body. that because the person sometimes he may want to go himself, but his love to the money make him miser, and he may delay sin. As we understand the necessity of money for life, and the necessity of money for preparing the army, and there's no way or no means for us to have the soldiers and the army ready for jihad without money. So the requirement of spending fi sabilillah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the cause of Allah is very important. We see how many people misunderstand the verse which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded the believer to spend in the cause of Allah and not to lead themselves toward destruction with their own hands. In actuality, right understanding of the verse that when the people start spending in the cause of Allah, this is will be the destruction, not by other means will be the destruction, except that the people will neglect the jihad, that the people will stop spending in the cause of Allah, so this will be the destruction for them. And here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning this hadith about the great reward of a person who is spending in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hadith was reported by Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, talking about a person who gave in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala two things that mean paired, that mean not only one thing of one kind, but he will give two things. For example, between male and female camels. So this would be much better than a person give a male camel only or a female camel only, because this would be more suitable and more beneficial for jihad, because the possibility of multiplying and having more camels by having both bears together. Nevertheless, regardless if the person spends two things in the cause of Allah or one thing in the cause of Allah, that the hadith came to show the superiority and the reward of a person spending in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how this became such a great reward to such a degree that the keepers of Jannah would be calling him here to enter Jannah from any door or any gate that you wish. We see this hadith that not only the person is permitted to enter Jannah, but here the jinns are calling on him, asking him to come and to enter, not only to enter, but to enter from any gate. We know that there is a gate in paradise, which is especially for those who observe the fasting, called Ar-Rayyan. But for a person who is spending the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be in all the gates for him to enter. And this shows the superiority and the great reward of a person who spends in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the angels will be calling him also and so. And this is also a means of honor by calling him by such name that he will love it. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, upon this, he said, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this person never can be doomed or destroyed. And upon this Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I hope you be one of those people that they will be called by the angels and they will be made to enter wish. This is a glad tidings that has been given by the Prophet ﷺ to Abu Bakr Siddiq. As we understand how Abu Bakr has supported the Prophet ﷺ at all causes, not only with himself only, but with himself and his wealth, especially in the time of Hijrah. He brought everything. And was a petition between Abu Bakr and Umar. Umar came with a portion of his money, but Abu Bakr came with all his money. And when the Prophet asked him, Oh Abu Bakr, what do you leave for your family? He said, I left for them Allah and His Messenger. The Prophet of Allah told us, no wealth of any human being had benefited me as much as the wealth of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him and all the Sahaba. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them all the best for their sacrifice and for their spending and doing what they did for Allah's cause. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Let's bring up the second hadith which is reported by Abu Sa'id Khudri, may Allah be pleased with him. And this hadith is very interesting and has a lot of frequency from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and literal and comprehensive terms which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it one of the speciality of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Jawami' al-Kalim is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say one word or one term which covers a lot of meaning. And this was something special for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He went to the minbar and fadda to the companions. And he warned them about this dunya and the temptation and the good things that comes out of this birth. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had informed them about all the blessings that will be coming out of being in this dunya and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring about many, many good things. And how Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so scared for them as a result of dunya being open and be so much for them. In this case, a man among the Sahaba stood up and questioned the Prophet ﷺ, how good can bring about evil? That means money is something good. How such a good lead person to something destruction for? Upon this, the Prophet ﷺ had remained silent. He didn't have the answer. What to say to the man? And the Sahaba in this moment, they assume that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is inspired and religion is coming to him. But this hadith is one of the hadiths that shows you that the sunnah is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as it came in many other incidents concerning the hijab for the mothers of believers, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Allah made the hijab for them and made for them to remain in the houses, later on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam been revealed to them that Allah had permitted them to go outside of the house for their necessity. Also the man that came during the ihram and he has a perfume in him and he questions the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have the answer until Jibreel came to him and told him that for this man to wash and remove this perfume that he has in his body. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that indeed I've been given the book and it's similar to the book, which is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After a while, coming silent well as the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to wipe the sweat from his forehead, which comes as a result of the revelation, which he used handkerchief as a result of the coming of the wahi. Such be in a cold day and a cold night, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be sweating. Here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, where is the person who had asked such a question? The question which was about, will good bring about evil? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if this is good, that money is good, that means the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling him, which meaning is that is not good in all time. And after this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a good example. He said, by the spring, when the spring comes, it brings about all these beautiful flowers and all these vegetation. During the springtime, we can see all these beautiful things outside, which you call some of the animals rush and eat until it becomes so full to such a degree that it will die out of him because it eats beyond their ability. And another form of these mosquitoes or these animals or these living things that will eat until they satisfy their own self and after they will sleep. The third time that will eat until it gets full, and after this it will wait until defecate and urinate and feel better and run and eat again and continue in this fashion. So in this hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam given example by the spring, which is money. The spring is something good. It doesn't bring about anything but good. But how the animals will act towards the spring. If they will eat a lot dirty and die, or they eat in this place, or they will eat and after this they run and defecate and eat later on and continue in a healthy condition. So the spring about brings about all the flowers and vegetation, but how this animal will act towards it. The same the human being will die. Money is good. Some people, they go and get this money. They don't worry. They don't care if it's halal or haram, if it's lawful or forbidden. They get the money by any means. And in the same time, they don't spend anything. So this person, he gets the money, something like this animal that ate beyond their ability and destroyed. So this man put the money in haram. He didn't do too much with it. All what he concerned collect the money. As a result of this, it went with him to hellfire. Another person does not mean that he have getting the money from haram. He may get in the money from halal, but he doesn't depend in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So will be also struck for him because he will be punished in hellfire. Though maybe in the end he will go to paradise. The third type of a human being, a person who will get money from the source and also will spend in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is good, just like the animal that ate from the vegetation of the spring and took enough to satisfy its needs, and after this waited until circulating this food and defecates and urine, and after this walks and it rises and will get more. This is exactly like the person getting the money from lawful means and also this is spending it in the cause of Allah. This is necessary. And look how the Prophet ﷺ gave us this kind of scenario of defecates and urinates. Although this defecation it means and good, it means of good for the person, for the animal, if without this it will die. So that means when you spend in the cause of Allah, this is exactly like a person defecating and urinating, because if this is remains in your stomach, that it can kill you. So spending, if the person holds the money but doesn't spend, will be like this animal that eats and eats, never defecates. And as in the Prophet ﷺ told us that this sucker is the impurity and the filth of the people. So a person shouldn't be looking up to this, because this is a means to clean the person out of his greed and love of his own self. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, money is good. This worldly property is sweet and vegetation. The sweet nation. But how excellent the wealth of the Muslim is in one condition, if you collect it through illegal means and hid it in Allah's cause, in what is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he who does not take this money from illegal way is like an eater who is never satisfied, and his wealth will be witness against him in the day of judgment. Allahu Akbar. The severity of one who prepares a ghazi, father in jihad, or looks after his dependents in his absence. Narrated Zayd ibn Khalid, may Allah be pleased with him, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he who prepares a ghazi going in Allah's cause is given a reward equal to that of a ghazi. And he who looks after property, and he who looks after properly the dependence of a ghazi going in Allah's cause is given a reward equal to that of a ghazi. Narrated Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, says Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used not to enter any house in the Medina except the house of Umm Sulaym, besides the house of his wife. He was asked concerning this. He said, I take pity on her, as her brother was killed in my company. After this, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi wrote a chapter concerning the reward and superiority of the person who prepare a person who going in the battlefield to participate in the fighting. This is very good hadith, because it gives a chance to the Muslims in general, especially those who would not participate in the fighting. A person can be in his house, can be getting a reward, and can share, get the equal reward of those who fight in the cause of Allah. So this is hadith is a great, because it's giving a chance to those for whatever reason they could not be part of the jihad, they can get the reward of jihad. And we understand that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told us that whosoever doesn't go in ghazw and didn't even think or consider to go to ghazw, and he died in this case, he will die upon a branch of hypocrisy. It's very necessary for the Muslim to be sincere and serious heart, and they have intention that one day that he's going to be in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fighting and doing jihad. Otherwise, if a person die in this case and he never thought about it, will be very serious. The statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed he had went, that means the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it shows that it's for sure that the person is going to be rewarded equal to the person who went in the ghazw. In some other narration, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he prepared the ghazi fully, that means he took care of all his needs, from clothes, food, traveling expenses, everything that fighter in the cause of Allah need. So a person receives this reward, although he is remaining in his house, that because he had to repair a person to part of the jihad. It came in another narration that both of them will share the reward. And this does not mean that he will get half. But that means both of them will be getting a similar reward, because whosoever leads other to good, he will get equal reward of the doer of that good. Also, this reward for a parent who take care of family of the ghazi, he keep on them. Because I understand that all the Muslims can go for jihad. Some people have to remain in the city to take care of the needs and the wants of the people. As example, it has to be a judge there, it has to be a ruler there, it has to be other people who take care of other needs and wants inside the city, while the people go outside to fight. So those people who are remaining in the city, if any one of them keep eye on the family of the person who went in jihad, take care of their needs and their wants, and also that he be honest, not betray the trust. And how serious it is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had informed us about a person betrays this trust with the wife of the man who had worked for ghazw. So he said he has to be with khair, with good. If he will do this, while he keeping the trust which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had trusted him with. And after this, he shows one of the practicality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that how he used to teach and implement teaching. Because Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is encouraging the people here to look after the family of the ghazi. Here is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go visit Sulaim. And he didn't enter any of the houses of people of Medina except this woman. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam questioned about it, he informed then that because her brother was killed in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as a result of this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to honor this, and he used to visit her, and he used to take care of her, It shows how it is important for the people to take care of the families of those people who went for Gaza. This does not have to be only during the time of the battlefield, but it can be after, especially if the person had passed away. The statement of Rasulullah that he was killed in my company does not mean that he was in the company of the Prophet when he died, but the Prophet had sent him for expedition and he died. That means he went with the order of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this was the Prophet meant that he be killed in my company. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to look after his sister, and this is the of mihram that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go and visit her and put his her house. Allahu Akbar. The Sheikh said, now inshallah this will be sufficient for today, and inshallah now we're going to open the questions and answers. For if there is any question related to our subject first. So please, if you have any question related to the subject concerning jihad, we will start with it inshallah. And please raise your hand first.